an economist. I'm just going to show it to you right now. This is really hard.
All right, we're going to talk economics, finance and commerce now with economics professor, finance professor, I think it is, at the University of New South Wales, Richard Holden. Thanks for your company.
Good to be here.
All right, I want to ask you about this effects test. I've written a little bit about it. It's been written about over the last few weeks, actually. Bruce Bilson, the small business minister, wants an effects test. Reportedly, Joe Hockey is concerned about it, as are other senior members of the cabinet. I understand Malcolm Turnbull has his doubts. Peter Costello has publicly been critical of it. But apparently the prime minister is backing his small business minister, Bruce Bilson. Give us a snapshot of what impact this has on small versus big business. What is an effects test?
So what this is changing Section 46 of the Competition and Consumer Act in the way that it prosecutes and assesses anti-competitive conduct. So what it says at the moment is that there's three parts.
I'm going to just stop Richard there for a second. You can go on YouTube and see the end of this video. But here is the situation. You are on Sky News. Lots of people watching you. There are big cameras, and there is this guy throwing at you a question. And you have limited to zero time to prepare. And as an economist, you need to listen to the question, put it in the context of the theory of the empirical body, and give a good answer. All of that you have to do in real time, with no ability to have a redo session. So this is perhaps the most difficult thing for an economist to do. Economists, we love to spend weeks in our offices thinking about things. We are shy. We don't do this thing because it's hard. But someone has to, and Richard has the ability to do it. He not only goes on television like this, he also publishes in the best journals that there are in the world. He has a PhD from Harvard. He taught and worked at MIT and Harvard, the best universities in the world. He's also, for the camera. Okay, we have a camera. So, my voice amplified instead of me screaming as usual. So he's also the editor of one of the most prestigious economic journals. Essentially, he does everything that an economist can dream of doing. And he's so good at what he does that the government gave him a grant, some money to do research, essentially. And this grant says, you cannot teach. You gotta do research, Richard, as much as possible. Don't teach too much, don't teach at all, do research. We actually are cheating a little bit today. We are a little bit cheating because we are inviting him in today for a class. And Scott now, French Scott, our lecturer in charge, is going to explain to you in a second how this lecture fits into the course. It has a very integral reason for being there. And after that, we are going to leave the stage to Richard, and he's going to do his thing, which is the ability of improv about economics on demand, which is really special. Scott, back at you.
Thank you, Alberto. This is a really cool opportunity that we have to have Richard here talking to us. And what he's going to do, as Alberto said, is not easy, right? So this isn't one of his papers that he spent months on that's going to be published in the Quarterly Journal of Economics. He's just looking at what's in the news today and recently, and talking about how we can think about those things through the lens of economics, right? And that's what we're trying to teach you in this course, is we're trying to just give you the tools to be able to look at the world, ask a question about how society works, about how we make decisions, and apply the concepts of economics to that. And so everything Richard's going to talk about is going to use the depths of his knowledge and expertise for his years of studying and doing research, but everything he's going to talk about is going to relate exactly to the concepts that you've learned already and that you're going to learn for the rest of the semester. So in fact, I don't encourage you to do it because you should pay attention, but you could pull up the course outline, and everything he talks about, you can find a topic, monopoly, externalities, imperfect competition, all these things that we're going to talk about later in the course, as well as marginal costs, marginal benefits. I bet that's going to come up a lot. These things are all super relevant to the world around you. So that's the idea of this, is to help you see how economists sort of in the quote-unquote real world think about things. So without further ado, Richard Holden.
Just put that up there. All right, welcome. Thanks for coming out early. And thanks to Alberto and Scott for those very kind and making me blush kind of introductions. Okay, so the guys gave you a very good outline of what we're going to try and do today. This is the first time we've tried to do this, so I'm a guinea pig, you're guinea pigs. It's a bit of an experiment. We'll see how it goes. As Scott mentioned, there's, you know, you've done quite a bit of stuff already in the course so far, where you're up to, but we're going to stretch that, and I'm going to talk about, through the lens of some stuff that I read in the newspaper this morning, some of it a little bit yesterday, but I was up early this morning reading the papers, looking for things that we could talk about. And we could talk about almost everything in the newspaper this morning, but you know, we haven't got time for that, so I picked out a few salient things. And you shouldn't feel that you've already covered the concepts we're going to talk about, and you'll probably walk out feeling, wow, I kind of got that a little bit, and I hope you're going to walk out saying, that sounds kind of interesting, I'm looking forward to later on in this course, maybe even courses in second and third year in economics that are going to go into those things in more detail. Okay, so if you walk out with your, you know, with a little more curiosity and your curiosity kind of peaked, then I'll be happy and I'll think that's a success, okay? So don't feel like, oh my gosh, he went through that in like 2 minutes and 30 seconds and it's information overload and I haven't understood it. You're not gonna walk out with a complete understanding of 3 years of economics today. If I could do that, Alberto really would have to be nice to me if I could manage that in 90 minutes, but that's beyond me, okay? And so part of this is I'm going to, you know, ask you a few questions, okay? And some of those, so we don't interrupt the flow, just going to have you say something and then I might repeat it back because I've got a mic and you folks don't have mics. When we get into possibly some extended questions, there are stand microphones and we'll have people come down to do that. We may or may not do that. Let's just see how it goes. As I say, we're playing with live ammo, so we'll just see how it turns out. All right. And you know, you should feel free to shout out any question, you know, maybe raise your hand given the number of people, but I can try and be responsive to that. Okay, so here's the Australian newspaper from this morning, the online version of the Australian newspaper. And of course, Brexit's a big thing today. Probably not gonna talk about that. One thing that did come up was, that struck me was this opinion piece by Jennifer Westacott. So she's president of the Business Council of Australia. So she represents business. She's got a particular perspective on things. Okay, and you've probably seen recently a decision by the Fair Work Commission about penalty rates. Does anyone remember what that decision said, roughly speaking? Okay, everyone's a little shy. Let me get the ball rolling then, okay? So this decision talked about what people are going to get paid on Sundays compared to Saturdays. So you might remember that, you know, people work in cafes and hairdressers and retail and various other things on Sundays got paid these penalty rates. They got paid extra money for working on a Sunday. The idea being that, you know, you're working on a Sunday, you can't hang out with your friends, you can't hang out with your family because, you know, they're not working, but you're working on Sunday, you should get paid a little extra for that to compensate you for the fact that you're giving something up. Okay, and that's been enshrined in employment law in Australia for a long time. And there's this body called the Fair Work Commission that basically helps adjudicate claims between employers and employees, you know, and sometimes represented by unions. And a claim went to them saying, you know what, we're paying so much on Sunday, it's, you know, a whole bunch of cafes saying they can't open, it's not economic for them to do that, people are not opening on Sundays, they're not hiring as many people, that's the claim. And so the idea was, from the Fair Work Commission, was, well, why don't we scale the Sunday back to Saturday rates, okay? So instead of paying you twice the normal wage, we're gonna pay you 1.5 times the normal wage, roughly speaking, okay? Now, you can imagine what the reaction to that was. One side of politics said, well, that's obviously sensible, we're all about creating jobs. And the other side of politics said, this is terrible. It's going to reduce people's take-home pay. These people are struggling. This is a horrible, horrible thing. Okay? So you can probably guess which side of politics said which one of those things. Okay? So here's Jennifer Westacott's intervention. I'm not going to read you the whole article. But as she says, parliamentarians who are weighing up whether to accept the independent umpire's decision on penalty rates must ask themselves five critical questions. By the way, if you're ever, no offense to Ms. Westacott, but if you're ever writing an article, try and have no more than three critical questions. People get lost after, you know, three, four, I can't remember what was four, what was two again. I would have encouraged her to have three. But she's got five critical questions, okay? Everyone from small business to Fair Work Commission and Productivity Commission believes that adjusting Sunday penalty rates can create more jobs, more hours, and more opportunities for small business. Okay, so that's the claim that business are pushing, and they have a way of understanding that. Now, you've already got a way of thinking about this, okay, and thinking about that claim. And so you've already seen a demand curve, right? We've got price here, and we've got quantity here, and you've got a demand curve, and it slopes down, right, most of the time. Standard textbook thing. And you've seen something that says something like, you know, think about the demand for wheat or the demand for corn or the demand for tomatoes or something like that, okay? And that's all true and that's all important. And that's definitely, you know, a leading example of what goes on. But as a very famous Nobel Prize winning economist, Gary Becker, who, you know, passed away relatively recently, unfortunately, who spent his career at the University of Chicago, one of the great things that he pointed, one of his great contributions was that he pointed out that you can think about supply and demand as applying to a whole bunch of things beyond, you know, wheat and corn and tomatoes and things like that, okay? And you can think about it applying to a whole range of things, and one very important thing that you can think about it applying to is to labor markets. So you can think of supply and demand of labor. You know, we all work, so I think about how much of my time to supply to labor, how many hours a week I'm going to work, am I going to do some additional things? I'm going to get paid by Sky News, but in a happier world where they paid me, I could think about how much time I want to spend going on Sky News and doing things like that, how much time I want to spend writing newspaper articles. That's my labor supply choice. And so you could think about a supply curve for the labor market being built up from the individual decisions of all of us folks who work, okay? Just the same way that you've thought about building up a supply curve from people, you know, who grow corn or grow wheat or make steel. And you can think about demand as coming from the employer side. So you can think about demand, you know, I think about demand from, you know, the vice chancellor and my dean and my head of school at the University of New South Wales. They have some demand for my labor services. But, you know, Ms. Westacott is talking about demand from particularly small businesses. She's talking about the demand for labor from hairdressers and cafe owners and Coles and Woolworths and Meijer and David Jones and, you know, any other retailer you want to think of, okay? Now, the demand curve for labor, we've seen this empirically over the last 50 years. There's been countless studies that empirically, statistically look at, so what is the demand curve for labor look like, and the demand curve for labor slopes down as well. Why is that? If I have to pay you a higher wage, I'm going to demand less of your labor. Just the same way that if I have to pay a higher price for corn, I'm going to buy less corn. Okay? And so, you know, the argument that's being put here, this is an argument that's been put, as Ms. Westacott says, by the Productivity Commission, by the coalition government, by a whole bunch of economists, and indeed by the Fair Work Commission, okay, who by the way were largely appointed by Labor governments, you know, who are currently on the other side of this issue. They're saying the demand curve for labor slopes down. So if you have really high Sunday penalty rates, firms are going to demand less labor. And so if we lower the price of hairdressers and baristas and people who clear plates and stuff, if we lower the price, we're going to increase demand. And what does that mean? Increasing demand is increasing the number of people who are going to be employed, okay? And it's kind of hard to get around that fact. That's kind of true, and you've already seen in this course your price theory, your supply and demand theory, is telling you exactly how that works. Okay, now, there's another side of that, which is these folks are getting paid less. Okay, that's not so good for them. Okay, and I'm gonna talk maybe a little bit later on, we'll see how it goes, about some facts about the rise in inequality. So if you're worried about inequality, you might say, so who are these people? You know, these are young people, these are people who are not particularly highly paid. Okay, maybe these are people who really rely on those penalty rates to be able to pay their rent or feed their kids or do various other things. So it's not like there's not a trade-off, but what your economics is telling you is it's giving you an analytic framework to think about that trade-off. So my take on it is both sides have a point, okay? If you like the slightly more conservative side of it, that's saying Sunday penalty rates mean there's gonna be less employment, you bet there is, okay? The more progressive side that's saying, yeah, but think about who the folks are who are gonna be worse off as an effect of this. You know, people who are paid $30,000, $40,000, $50,000 a year, people who are struggling, you know, maybe they're a lot of single parents, maybe they're young people scrambling to pay the rent, and things like that. Yeah, that's right as well. So how do you make that trade-off? There's a point on one side and there's a point on the other side. So how are you gonna make that trade-off? You could have kind of an ideological viewpoint about it, which says like, I always like more jobs and I don't really care about who loses. Or you could have the other ideological trade-off that says, you know, I always wanna like have higher wages and I don't really care about what the unemployment rate is. To me, both of those things sound wrong. And a big part of what economics is about, in a sense, what all of economics is really about, is about how to balance trade-offs. There are lots of different trade-offs in lots of different contexts, but in this context, the trade-off is about thinking about employment versus wages. Now, you're not gonna solve that by drawing a picture like I did. It's an empirical question. It's about how much. So you've got to start asking yourself, well, if I lower the rate by a few dollars, how much more employment is that going to generate? If it's going to generate like a ton more jobs, maybe the trade-off tilts in favor of the Business Council of Australia's view of it or the coalition government's view of it. If it's going to create like only a few more jobs, but it's really going to hurt the folks who are getting paid less, maybe the balance, the trade-off tilts in favor of what the Australian Labor Party are currently the case they're prosecuting in Parliament and in the press. Now, how are you gonna figure that out? Well, you're gonna have to use one of the concepts that you've just recently come across, which is the price elasticity of demand. So you're gonna have to figure out how elastic demand for labor is. So if you remember what that is, it's how much of a percentage change in demand there is for a percentage change in price, okay? And a lot of what certain parts of the economics profession do and certain economists do, and if you worked at the Productivity Commission or if you indeed intern, say, at the Fair Work Commission, or if you work in a field called labor economics, part of what you would do is to try and figure out what that demand curve looks like, what the slope of it is and where we are on it in order to figure out that elasticity. Okay, but at the heart of it, it's all about a trade-off. So the thing I want you to take away from that is sort of twofold. One is that supply and demand, you might learn it usefully like I did in the context of some agricultural commodity, but it applies to almost everything. It applies to labor markets. It applies to dating markets. It applies to the marriage market, okay? It applies to demand for almost anything that you consume in a very broad sense of the word. It's maybe a little off-putting to think about, you know, consuming dating or, you know, consuming marriage or something like that, but at some level, that's Gary Becker's lesson, that you can use your price theory to think about all these kinds of things. Now, of course, you wouldn't expect the president of the Business Council of Australia to say what I just said, which is like, on the one hand, on the other hand, it's complicated, it's an empirical question, don't worry, we've got someone out back calculating the elasticity, and in a month or so, you know, they'll give you a very dry academic presentation that'll put you to sleep. Okay, that's not her job, right? Her job is she's an advocate. She's gonna put her side of the case. Goodness knows there are folks aggressively putting the other side of the case. Okay, so we'll throw up on Moodle, for those who are interested, there's a paper written about 10 or 12 years ago by a very famous economist, maybe one of the finest economists of his generation, a French economist called Jean Tirole. won the Nobel Prize about 4 years ago, and he has this beautiful paper called Advocates, which is all about showing you, using the tools of game theory, why it turns out that in the marketplace for ideas, you're going to end up with people who have to basically stand heavily on one side of the seesaw to counterbalance people standing heavily on the other side of the seesaw. So that's always helped me understand that, you know, Ms. Westacott is doing her job and is not being unreasonable by not giving you the little trade-off speech that I just gave you. And equally, we wouldn't expect Bill Shorten to say, you know, it's all complicated, of course this is going to create some more jobs, but I'm just kind of on the other side of the thing, right? He's going to forcefully put the argument to stand heavily on the other side of the seesaw. So we'll throw that up on Moodle for you. Okay. Now, speaking of game theory, here's another one that I came across that I liked. So I'm always worried when I put up things to do with popular culture from when, like, I grew up, because I've come to realize I'm very old now. And I was guest lecturing something at MIT last year, and I made some popular culture reference, and these folks are like in their 30s, right? So I'm not that old. Well, I'm older than 30, but I'm, you know, in the scheme of things. And I put up something about popular culture to these folks in their 30s, and they looked at me with the blankest stare you have ever seen. Like, what are you talking, are you speaking another language that we don't understand or something like that? And that's the point at which I realized I'm old. So for those of you who don't know, this is Prince. Okay, he was famous when I was growing up. He recently died from a drug overdose, which is kind of sad. But he was a great performer. And in the wash-up of his death, there's a whole question about what happens to the rights to his music. So as you probably know, every time a radio station, you know, plays somebody's song, they gotta cough up a few cents to whoever owns the right to the music. Okay, that's basic kind of copyright law. And in fact, another musician who died recently, David Bowie, who you also probably don't know, was one of the pioneers, actually, or his music was pioneering in thinking about how these streams of revenue work. So as a very brief aside before we talk about Prince, there became known as a thing called Bowie bonds. Anyone heard of Bowie bonds? Anyone want to guess what they are? So you got this stream of 10, 5 cents, 2 pennies and stuff coming in all the time. And you know the person's famous and they've sold a lot of records. And you know this stuff is going to get played over and again. You know, people are going to go to parties and DJs are going to get requested this thing, and it's going to be in jukeboxes and radio stations have to fill up the 24 hours in a day and so on. So you know that there's going to be this stream of 5 cent coins coming in, okay? But you probably don't want to, if you're David Bowie and you want to buy a yacht or something or a big house, you probably don't want to worry about the 5 cent coins coming in to pay that down. You'd like the money now, right? So you've got a stream of money that's going to come in, maybe 50, 100 years out into the future, and you want to monetize that today. So some clever investment bankers came along and said, we know how to do this. This is just like mortgage-backed securities that you probably heard about during the financial crisis. This is like a stream of mortgage payments that's going to come in, and we can, you know, do some modeling of what that's going to look like, figure out a value, we can discount those cash flows back to today, we can say what's a dollar 3 years from now worth in today's money, and we can come up with a product that we can sell to people. We can say, just like you can invest in residential mortgages, just like you can invest in the debt of BHP Billiton or CBA, you can invest in David Bowie's royalty stream. And there are folks running around who've, you know, superannuation funds, sovereign wealth funds, wealthy individuals who got to find things to invest in. They often invest in bonds. So there was created this thing called Bowie bonds. Okay, and there were hundreds of millions of dollars of these things that were sold, and it's really selling the rights to the future stream. So a similar thing went on with, so this became like a thing. And a similar thing went on with Prince. And then the question is, in his estate, you know, after he died, you know, how are these things going to be sold off and who's going to get them and so on? Okay? And so the article says, this is from the Wall Street Journal, Universal Music Group in January won the licensing rights to Prince's Vault, a trove of the late pop star's unreleased music. Okay, so this is new stuff that's not released, that the bonds haven't already been sold off. But there wasn't much of a bidding war. The auction process is raising questions among people close to Prince's estate about whether the estate could have earned more for the rights than the $30 million that they said Universal ended up agreeing to pay, okay? And I won't go further into the article right now, but basically they said, well, there's this auction for these rights. People are gonna bid in this auction for it. And they were worried about how many people got to show up to the auction. So it turns out there were some potential bidders who kind of got excluded from the auction. And you might say to yourself, and what they're saying in the article or what these heirs of Prince are saying is, well, if you only have like a couple of people bidding in the auction, they're not gonna bid as high a price as if there were like 10 people being really competitive and bidding in the auction, then you'd expect there to be a higher price, okay? And again, something that you'll cover at some point in economics courses is a whole field about called auction theory, which is about how to design auctions, okay? And this has come off the back of game theory. We might discuss a little bit of that later on, but who's heard of John Nash? Or seen the movie A Beautiful Mind, or read the book A Beautiful Mind? Bunch of people, right? So you might remember that John Nash developed this concept of equilibrium points. This is about if I'm playing against you in some game, and that game could be a trade war, a bidding war, a price war, chess, could be any kind of thing, how does the optimal thing for me to do, my strategy, depend on the optimal thing for you to do and vice versa? And Nash won the Nobel Prize for creating a framework for thinking about that. He called them equilibrium points, and they became known as Nash equilibrium. The concept became known as Nash equilibrium. Okay, so that's one rule in economics, is you don't get to name things after yourself. If it's good enough, then people will tell you later on. So, you know, Alberto can't write a paper called Motta's theorem. Okay, we have to come along later and say that was a really good theorem, and you know, we're gonna give you credit for it. Okay, so picking up on this Nash equilibrium concept, a bunch of economists in the late 1970s and early 1980s, and it's an active field on into today, into the present, picked up on this and said, you know, you can use this game theory, this theory of strategic interactions, okay, to think about how to design auctions. We see auctions in the world all the time, and we see different kinds of auctions. So we see second price auctions. So what's a second price auction? A second price auction is where obviously the highest bidder gets the object, but they pay the bid of the second highest bidder. Okay, so that's one way you can do it. There are first price auctions. So if you go to a home loan auction in Sydney this weekend, you'll see the highest bidder, as long as it's above a reserve price, which is another design feature, a minimum price that the seller's willing to sell at. If you go to a home auction, you'll see that the highest bidder, the first price bidder, gets the house and they pay their own bid. So that's a first price auction, they pay the highest bid. But once you start thinking about that, you say to yourself, well, what about a third price auction? What about a fourth price auction? What about a fifth price auction? And if you're the seller, you start saying to yourself, well, which one is best? Okay, I mean, now help me. Tell me what auction design I should use. There are all sorts of other features. Should I have an entry fee to bid? Should you have to pay a show-up fee to get into the thing or not? Should I have a reserve price or not? Should I announce what the reserve price is, the minimum price I'm willing to sell at? What happens if the bidders anticipate that if they don't bid the reserve price, then we're gonna go into some one-on-one negotiation after that? I mean, they're gonna think ahead, right? And they're gonna think about that. And is it really credible for me as a seller to say, you didn't bid the reserve price, go away, I'm not talking to you. What if I've got to sell my house? I really want to sell my house, I bought another house. So all these design features are really important. And there are a lot of economists who've worked on this, but two very notable ones, Paul Milgram and Robert Wilson, Bob Wilson at Stanford University, been real pioneers in thinking about how to design these auctions. And this has had huge practical implications, okay? So the way that the 3G and 4G spectrum has been sold off, all designed by economists to try and maximize revenue for the government, okay? The Federal Communications Commission in the US, has a bunch of economists who work on this stuff, who think about auction design and how to design things. When Google went public, when they took their company from being a privately held company to a publicly traded company, they didn't go through a traditional initial public offering process, IPO process. They auctioned off their shares. And they enlisted economists, indeed at Stanford, to think about how to design that. And when Alibaba went public, there were these considerations as well. So this stuff is everywhere, and it's something where economists are really involved. Again, well, I'll throw up this anecdote on Moodle, and I won't dwell on it too much. And you know, as an Australian, you know, we have this rivalry, and it's always fun to make fun of New Zealanders. So I don't want to do that here. But when the New Zealand government was selling off their 3G spectrum, okay, they got some consultants in from a consulting firm that I won't name, and said, "How should we design the auction?" And the economist came in and said, "Look, you know, I've taken an MBA class, and let me tell you this: there's this remarkable property of a second price auction, and this is true. There's a remarkable property of a second price auction." And that is that you can do no better as a bidder. You're just being a selfish pig taking care of yourself. You can do no better than bid what it's truly worth to you, not a penny more, not a penny less. Even though you know what it's worth to you, the seller doesn't. In a second price auction, the optimal strategy for a bidder is to bid their true valuation. And so these consultants came in and said, what could be better than having people reveal their private information and bid their true value? So it turns out if they'd taken a second course in auction theory, they would have learned that the revenues that the government expects to get are more volatile in a second price auction. There's a bigger spread of what you might expect to get in a second price auction than in a first price auction, which is why economists in most situations would tell you, you want to run a first price auction, okay? First price auction is going to get you the same amount of revenue in expectation, but have less volatility around it, less variance around it. But the New Zealand government went ahead and used a second price auction, and you can read the story further on Moodle. It didn't turn out very well for them. There was some stuff that went for $55 million and identical objects that went for $5,000. So you imagine being a government minister that has to stand up and say, we got these fancy consultants in, we spent a bunch of money on them, they told me what to do, and I sold two identical things, one for $55 million and one for $5,000, because you know I didn't flip to page 20 of the textbook, I stopped at page 10, okay? So maybe they should have got some fancier economists in to deal with that. Okay, so auctions all over the place. Now, here's one that I liked recently. This came out late yesterday afternoon and then this morning. So it's titled, Danica Louise Lena in Court Accused of $1.3 million Macquarie Bank Fraud. Okay? So with a Louis Vuitton bag slung over her arm and wearing Chanel shoes, a woman has appeared in court accused of funneling $1.3 million from Macquarie Bank accounts into her own. Danica Louise Lena, 26, from Des Moines, don't know why that's relevant, appeared in a Downing Centre local court on Wednesday charged with 21 counts of using a false document to obtain financial advantage. Court documents allege Ms. Lena began using a fake Macquarie Bank account withdrawal form to transfer $5,000 from an account linked to an apartment building to her own Commonwealth Bank account in September 2013. Over the course of the next 18 months, she allegedly used a similar form to withdraw money from different Macquarie Bank accounts 20 times, including amounts of $80,000 and change, $100,000, $116,000. She's accused of wrongfully transferring over $1.3 million. Okay, so here's this person. She's obviously, I don't know whether she committed this crime or not. I mean, that's for a court to decide. And as the journalist said, it's alleged. But she's accused of stealing $1.3 million. To buy expensive stuff. And when appearing to try and presumably plead not guilty and get herself off from this, she walks in, dressed all fancy, possibly with the proceeds of this alleged crime, with a Louis Vuitton bag over her arm. Okay, and she's gonna face, I'm guessing she's gonna face a jury of her peers, so there are gonna be 12 folks sitting there, and she's got a, what's a Louis Vuitton, someone tell me, what's a Louis Vuitton bag, a genuine one, not like one out of the back of a truck somewhere, you know, in New York City. Like $5,000, $10,000, north of that. It's got to be at least five, right? So she's walking in, you know, with a bag that's worth as much as some people's car and saying, I didn't commit fraud. So one possibility is that she's mentally ill, okay? And indeed, let me say just quickly as an aside, talking about Gary Becker again, criminal law, lawyers, legal scholars around the world, until Gary Becker started writing about this in the 1960s, that was their view of all criminals. It was just something wrong with them. And that's why they committed crimes. And what Becker pointed out in a very famous paper called Crime and Punishment, not the Dostoevsky book, but a very famous paper, he said, you know what? It's actually a pretty rational calculus. You know, when it comes down to it, what are people balancing when they commit a crime? There's some benefits of committing the crime, and there's some expected cost. There's like some probability I get caught, and there's some punishment conditional on me getting caught, and I'm just doing cost-benefit analysis. I'm not mentally ill. I'm just sitting there saying, I know there's a benefit, I know there's some cost, and let me trade those two things off. And he actually came up with this idea when he was running late to give a seminar paper and in New York City and was looking for a parking spot. And he was running late, and he said, the way he used to tell the story was, he said to himself, couldn't find a legal park. Okay, I'm running late. I know there's a cost to me running late for my talk. That's bad, that's unprofessional. I feel bad about that. And that's gonna like cost me a little bit of reputation, and I'm not gonna get to talk for as long, and that's a bummer. And then there's this illegal parking spot, and I know the fine's like $50, but I might not get caught. So I thought, what are the chances of me getting caught? And I thought it was like 10%. So then I thought, well, the expected fine is like $5. And then I said to myself, would I pay $5 to be on time for my talk? Of course. That's a no-brainer. And so the way he thought about it, now that's not, you know, it's not really a crime. I mean, it's not the world's worst thing in the world to park in like a no-parking zone. I mean, this wasn't a handicapped zone, it wasn't anything like that. So he's committed this like sort of relatively minor breach, and he's done his cost-benefit analysis to figure it out. So, as I say, maybe there's something wrong with her, or maybe she's actually very, very cunning indeed. And she's read her social psychology and the part of economics that's become known as behavioral economics, which says that, you know, people try to be rational most of the time, and it's probably better for them most of the time if they are rational. But sometimes people do things that aren't perfectly rational. And they're informed by, you know, we're all sort of a little bit defective, and we suffer from a bunch of biases. And very famous social psychologists, you might have heard of Danny Kahneman and Amos Tversky, who were very famous social psychologists who really helped bring this stuff to the attention of economists. I'll tell you the key economist who really brought this stuff to life. And they pointed out, through a series of laboratory experiments, getting people into carefully designed and controlled situations where they can ask them questions and provide them incentives and payments to do things, pointed out that people suffer from these sort of cognitive biases, and maybe people don't behave exactly the way you would think. And I'll talk about that in a second, but one of the things that has been shown over and again by social psychologists is that people assess each other unconsciously or not based on their appearance. Okay, so there are all these things about how people who are deemed to be good looking get free stuff all the time. Okay, and I'm not just talking about free drinks at bars, I'm talking about they get like, turns out that in all sorts of retail settings they get cut slack and cut advantage. People are just nicer to good looking people. And there's all sorts of studies in criminology that talk about the fact that how a defendant is dressed, okay, affects the probability that they can get convicted of a crime and what sentence they get. I'm not saying that's a good thing, but I'm saying that it's a pretty well-established fact. So maybe she's really smart, which is she's walked in there and said, if I dress up and look good and look like a slick person, then I've got a lower chance of being convicted, and I'm going to convince the jury, okay, of that. So maybe she's actually really clever after all. So there's a whole field, as I said, called behavioral economics, and we have courses on this. These are you know, second year and third year courses, but we have a bunch of courses on this in the School of Economics, which I think are great. And this is a burgeoning field, okay? And it was really created by a guy called Richard Thaler, who picked up, he's known as Dick Thaler, and he's a professor at the University of Chicago, and a very keen golfer, among other things. And he really understood very early on the insights of Kahneman and Tversky, and he worked with those folks on research papers very early on, and he really helped bring these insights into mainstream economics. And it was resisted for a long time. For a long time, people were like, we've got our supply and demand, we've got our person maximizing utility, and now you want to complicate things. Get lost. It's hard enough as it is without having to put in things like this. But Dick had, this is a poster that's in the University of Chicago Booth School of Business lobby. They have these big, I used to work there, we have these big posters there where you know, some of the heroes, you know, Nobel Prize winners, future Nobel Prize winners, there's a little blurb about them. I won't read you the whole thing, but he has this, so Dick's a really funny guy as well. So he has this kind of pithy quote. You have to think of him saying this sort of tongue in cheek. Okay, I think it is possible to strengthen economics by incorporating the idea that some people behave like humans at least some of the time. Okay, and that's a whole field about thinking about how to incorporate these behavioral insights into economics. So you might have heard of, or you will hear about, a whole lot of these biases. So one of them is, I'll just give you just a handful of them. So one of them is loss aversion, okay? People seem to dislike losses more than they like gains, even when they should leave them exactly the same way off according to our standard models, what's known as expected utility theory. So our models are telling us they give people the same, essentially, payoff, the same utility, but over and over and over again, even when you point it out to people, people just don't like losing stuff, okay? And that gives them a kind of bias towards the status quo, and it makes them take behaviors that try and avoid making losses. And this has really big implications for not just how people make decisions, but for how stocks and bonds and asset prices evolve, and how things are, and how securities price formation works. And there's a whole big part of financial economics which talks about how you can help predict stock market behavior based on the fact that people seem to be loss averse. And in fact, a bunch of hedge funds have, particularly in the United States, have trading strategies which are specifically about exploiting behavioral biases. So there are things that are well known, like the announcement effect. So a company announces unexpectedly good results, okay? There's this big bump up in their share price, but then it tends to mean revert over time. People have an unexpectedly bad result, there's a big dip, and then it mean reverts back up over time. And really clever hedge fund managers, often these things were pioneered by behavioral economists, in fact, have figured out that if you get a trading strategy that works very well timed around these things, you have to get the timing just right, you can make a bunch of money, okay? And even after this is known, and it's published, and it's in books, it still persists, a lot of this stuff. It's a little bit less strong than it was in the past, but this still persists. And so for those of you who are interested in, you know, more parts of financial economics, there's a whole lot of stuff around this. There's things called the January effect. There's stuff about what happens near holidays. There's how stocks trade on rainy days and on Mondays. That all seems to be about how humans process information, okay? There's another one that's particularly important, which is what I like to refer to as the mug experiments, okay? The more formal name for it is the endowment effect. But here's the way people do these experiments. They give people, so they do it as, we'll talk about randomization in just a minute, but they put people into two groups, randomly chosen, often done with students in class, been more organized, maybe we could have done it today. And you give some people money, and you give some people coffee mugs of an equivalent value. And you basically ask people whether they prefer the coffee mug or the money, right? And it turns out that there's a difference in what people are willing to pay to buy the coffee mug compared to what they're willing to accept to give up the coffee mug if they were given it, if they were endowed with it. And this is the so-called endowment effect. Somehow you give people something, they seem to like it. And so they want more money for it to give it up than they were willing to pay to get it in the first place. And this is like, this is a coffee mug, okay? This isn't a, like a dog or a child, okay? This is a coffee mug that they've had for a minute, okay? And somehow they've formed a bond with it where they're like, no, this is my mug. You're gonna have to pay me $25 to get my mug. I know I said I'd be willing to buy it for 20, but now I've got the mug, I want 25. Okay, and again, you tell them, like, you're being irrational, okay? This is not right. And they do it over and over and over again, and this thing's replicated all around the world. Okay, so this isn't just 19-year-old American university students who happen to have something with mugs. It's true everywhere in the world, okay? And so this endowment effect, you know, at one level, I really don't care if people get attached to coffee mugs, okay? That's not changing my view of the world. I don't want some tax to intervene with it. I don't want some big education program. You know, don't drink and drive. Make sure you trade a coffee mug for the same price you're willing to pay for it. We're not gonna do that. But what I do care about is when people suddenly get super attached to a government policy that's in place, or the constitution of a country, or a particular law, or something like that. Or they get particularly attached to a house that they can't really afford, that when they get older, they should be trading down to a more manageable property that would change housing affordability, say, in Sydney, be better for them, maybe have them be under less financial stress and less reliant on government assistance and things like that. And so once the endowment effect starts affecting real stuff, big stuff, okay, then it can have very powerful implications. And again, there's a whole lot of people exploring that stuff. So behavioral economics, despite the resistance that came from many people, I have to say myself included, is very powerful and very important when used wisely. So speaking of randomization, okay, so here's one that I saw yesterday. So as I said, I'm getting old, so anything that can tell me like how I can find I'm also busy. So if I can find some quick way to get a bit thinner, I'm all ears. And so when I saw earth-shattering study reveals the best exercise for anti-aging, I was like, I'm clicking on that one for personal consumption, okay? But it also turns out our economics can help us understand that a little bit better as well. So the secret to keeping your body youthful may be found in the way you move. So that wasn't so insightful, that sounds right, you know? Sit on a sofa for a long time eating potato chips, not so good. You know, run marathons, those folks are thin. A new study has found that high intensity interval training, I didn't know it was called HEAT, but okay, can essentially stop cellular aging in its tracks and in some case rejuvenate the cells that repair damage in the body. Okay, so I started reading this and I thought, okay, firstly, this is gonna be useless, but maybe it's gonna be a teachable moment for this class tomorrow morning. Because a lot of these studies, what do? They look at people who do something, and they look at some people who don't do that thing, and then they measure some outcome. And they say, look, the people who do the thing have a better outcome than the people who don't do the thing, okay? So they often look at something like, for instance, pregnant women who eat fish, and they say, we've collected all these data, and it turns out that women who ate a lot of fish when they were pregnant, their kids get better test scores when they're in fourth grade. Okay, and they track them over time, and they spend a lot of money and a lot of time. These are very well-meaning people, right? And they say, look, what's their conclusion? Look, eat the fish, smarter kid, we want smarter kids, eat more fish, okay, when you're pregnant. And then some of them say, the government should be subsidizing the fish. for the pregnant women, okay? And maybe there was another the billboard campaign again. Don't drink and drive. If you're pregnant, how about a salmon burger? And I'm sympathetic to the conclusion. It kind of feels right to me. I like fish too. Never been pregnant, but I like fish. And that sounds kind of right, but that's a hopeless way to determine whether it's right or not. That's a very bad way to do social science. Why might that be? Can anyone tell me why that might that be? Yes. Okay, so Elizabeth has hit the nail right on the head, which is, so what she said is, you know, it doesn't take into account your socioeconomic status. I'm paraphrasing a little bit, but this is the gist of what she said. It doesn't take into account your background and your socioeconomic status. So if you're like wealthy, of course your kid's gonna do better on a test. Maybe they go to a better school. Maybe you have more time and inclination to do homework with them. Maybe you value education more because the way you got wealthy is, you know, you got a really good education. You went to UNSW. You then came back and did another degree at UNSW later on and, you know, did a master's degree and learned even more, okay? And went out into the workforce, okay? These folks are not the same groups. The people who eat the fish and the people who don't eat the fish, that's not the only difference, okay? There's a whole lot of other differences, okay? And so, if you just look at what's known as observational data, okay, however good it is, you're gonna have a very hard time figuring out the causal impact. And that's what we care about, right? Because the intervention is, if you eat more fish when pregnant, your kid will be smarter. That's the claim, okay? Not people who eat fish when pregnant have smarter kids. And that's like dinner party conversation. That's fine, but it's not that interesting. It's certainly not interesting from a policy perspective. So if you wanna understand the policy perspective, you wanna understand the causal effect. So what's to be done? Okay, so one thing people did for a very long time was they said, like Elizabeth pointed out, but there are all these other factors. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna try and control for those factors. I'm gonna try and take account of those factors. So what am I gonna do? Well, I'm gonna collect data on their income level. But there's other things that affect. I'm gonna collect data on their education level, okay? And then people run a regression, which if you haven't seen already, you'll see later on, which is just a statistical way of accounting for these things, okay? And then they publish a paper that says, see, there's even controlling for these other couple of things, there's still an effect of eating fish on kids' test score outcomes. But then someone comes along and says, you didn't record whether the woman smoked while she was pregnant. And that has an effect. So someone then says, I'll throw smoking into the regression. New paper, publish that one. And then someone says, nah, turns out whether they like drank a lot of alcohol while they're pregnant, that matters. So throw that one in the regression. Publish another paper. And pretty soon, you start realizing that you're never gonna capture everything. Okay, even if you had all the data in the world, we don't know what all the relevant dimensions are. And for sure, we're not gonna have data on all those relevant dimensions. So this kind of running regressions where you control for the differences between the two groups, that is a fool's errand, okay? So economists, and really economists were at the forefront of this, okay, really realized this. So this is of relevance to people who do political science, who do public health, people who do anthropology. It's of relevance across the sciences and social sciences, and it was really economists, wasn't me, so I feel fine kind of attributing a lot of credit to a bunch of economists who came along and said, you know what, there is a way to do it. We should do a randomized controlled trial, sometimes abbreviated to an RCT. And they said, we know how to do this. This is what medical researchers do when they do like drug trials. So if you want to find out whether some medication maybe helps people stop having heart attacks, right? You don't say, here's a survey, tell me if you take the medication and then I'll control for your age and how many heart attacks you've had and what your weight is, how many cheeseburgers a week you eat and all that sort of stuff. You take a group of folks, and you take 100 of them, and you give them the heart medication, and 100 of them, you give them a sugar pill, a placebo, so that they think they're taking the heart medication, And then you look at the differences between the two groups. Now, why does that work? Well, because you've randomized, right? And so the two groups, on average, on every dimension, if the groups are big enough, they should be, on average, equal on all these dimensions, okay? And that's due to some, why does it have to be big enough? Well, that's due to something that you might have heard of known as the law of large numbers, okay? Basically, think of it as, you know, if I ask you to flip a fair coin three times, there's a chance that you're gonna flip three heads, okay? You can figure out the cheap homework exercise, figure out what's the probability you flip three heads or flip three tails, okay? It's pretty high. But if I ask you to flip a coin 1,000 times, the chances that it's, you know, very far away from 50-50 are very small. Okay, these are independent flips of a fair coin. And that's exactly analogously what's going on with randomization. And this has had a huge impact in a whole range of the social sciences. I should say this study, so I thought it was going to be a cautionary tale, but it's done by the Mayo Clinic. These folks know what they're doing. Researchers from the Mayo Clinic took 36 men and 36 women and randomized them. Now, I'm not so jazzed about 36. You know, I'd like to see 100 for this law of large numbers reason, but they randomized it. And there's ways of testing statistically whether 36 was big enough and stuff like that. Maybe it is. Okay. This has had huge implications across the social sciences. So a whole area, Sarah Walker, for instance, works in this area, and Alberto as well, in development economics. Okay, so there are lots of economists all over the world, but three of them who have all visited the School of Economics in the last 2 years, who, mark my words, in the next 10 years will receive the Nobel Prize, all three of them together in the one citation in the 1 year. They're professors at Harvard, Michael Kramer, and at MIT, Abhijit Banerjee and Esther Duflo. And what they have done is they have, over the course of nearly two decades, said, if we want to figure out what works to try and raise living standards in the developing world, we're going to have to do these randomized controlled trials. And so we want to figure out what's the most effective way to combat malaria. Maybe it's giving out bed nets. So we could have like some well-meaning folks from the World Bank come and tell us, you know, the bed nets, they're very good, we should do that, we should hand out a lot of bed nets, I know it costs money, we should hand out bed nets. And what Esther and Abhijit and Michael said is, well, look, we've got finite resources, there's only so much money to go into this stuff, we better figure out what works in the most cost-effective way. So maybe it's bed nets, maybe it's people running around giving, anti-malaria pills, maybe it's working really hard on vaccines, maybe it's working hard on mosquito eradication and draining swamps and marshes and things like that. It's an empirical question. And they have done this across the world, across a whole range of issues that are incredibly pressing, affecting the poorest people in the world, okay? And we can draw from these studies causal inferences that now affect policy about how to deal with these things. And that's something where economics has really been at the forefront. So earth-shattering study, I don't know, but at least they did it right. Okay, let's think about something a little more economic-y, if you like, in the traditional sense of the word. One of the things I'm trying to persuade you of is that, you know, economic thinking is kind of everywhere and relevant to a whole bunch of stuff, but let's go back to something that, you know, my dad would think was economics, taxes. Okay, so as you are probably aware, there is currently a large debate about whether or not to cut company taxes in Australia. Okay, so you might remember that the coalition government announced a plan at the last budget, last May, which is to, over the course of 10 years, mind you, gradually cut our company tax rate from, what percent is it now? Some people do know. 30%, maybe some budding entrepreneurs who are paying 30% company tax on their little business on the side while they're attending economics at UNSW. To cut it to 25%, okay? And part of the argument is we've got to be internationally competitive. President Trump's talked about cutting the US rate to 15%. He actually wanted to cut it to 10, but He doesn't always get what he wants. Who knows what's going to happen? Congress in the US are now just starting to consider that. So talking about cutting it potentially to 15%. The UK have talked about cutting it to 17%. Singapore's already in that territory. Ireland even lower. And so the argument that's being made in part is we've got to be internationally competitive. Why would you want to invest in Australia and pay 30% company tax if you invest in these other places that have got good institutions and rule of law and protections and, you know, speak the language and all that sort of stuff, if you're going to pay double the tax rate? Fair question. And then again, on the other side of politics, at least recently, they've said, no. This is a $50 billion handout to the big end of town, okay? And what's been thrown back at the Labor side of politics is, didn't you folks say, like a year and a half ago, that you thought it was a good idea to cut company taxes, okay? And they kind of did. And you can form your own view about that by reading the transcripts, but my reading of it is that senior members of the ALP certainly did say that cutting it to 25% was an important thing. And what's the argument that was made at the time and was made in the Henry Tax Review that was commissioned several years ago and largely ignored by the Rudd government? It said the following: the incidence of the tax doesn't fall on business, it falls on workers. What does that mean? How can that be? So economists understand this in the following way. There's a thing known as the statutory incidence of a tax. It's a sort of boring terminology, but it's apposite, okay? So the statute, the law, says business pays 30% tax on profits, okay? So the statutory incidence is the business has to pay the money. Workers aren't paying the money, the business is paying the money, okay? But there's a difference. We economists distinguish between the statutory incidence of a tax and the economic incidence of a tax. Okay, so what's the economic incidence? That is who actually bears the true cost of it. Not who pays the money, but who is made worse off by the tax. Who's, if you like, we sometimes refer to it as whose welfare, well-being, is reduced by the tax. And almost all economists agree that, I would say all economists agree, otherwise they're not economists, that the economic incidence of company tax is actually borne by workers. How can that be? Okay? And the reason is that there's, broadly speaking, two things that go into making stuff. And we call this a production function, F. So this is something that says, you give me an amount of K, capital, money, plant, machines, stuff like that, physical capital, and an amount of L, labor, and my F function will tell you how much I can produce. Okay, so I need a coffee machine and beans, and I need a barista. So I need some capital and I need some labor, and I'll tell you the value of the coffees that I can produce in some given amount of time. So that's what a production function does. You'll see one of these, okay? And, you know, it's hard, you don't walk around, I can't go to my local coffee shop and say, what's your F function look like? But the concept is, it's a useful abstraction that says there's an amount of capital and amount of labor that go into producing stuff, okay? But what's important to remember is the amount of capital and the amount of labor that's going to be used is something that's chosen. It's chosen by the producer, it's chosen by the firm. So the firm could buy an extra coffee machine, they can employ an extra barista, they could do a variety of different things, they could employ them for more hours, okay? They could give them an assistant, various other things. So they can vary the amount of capital and the amount of labor. And when you change the tax rate, people don't just sit there and say, oh, they changed the tax rate, I'll tell my accountant. They say, maybe I should change how I do business. Maybe I should vary the amount of capital and the amount of labor that I put into this stuff, okay? So how easy or hard is it for capital labor to move around when you change the tax rate? Well, in the very short term, it's hard to move capital around. Got my coffee machine, I could always buy another one, but you know, it's a bit sticky. So in the short term, capital is going to be fairly what we call immobile. But in the long term, capital moves all around the world. It gets wired around. We know how that works. Big mining projects happen or don't happen. And you know, tens of billions of dollars slosh in and out of Australia, in part dependent on what the tax rate is. Labor can move, but it's a lot harder. I can move to the United States. Not everyone can. It's a big decision. I've got two kids. I've got to move them. It's complicated. Okay. So labor is generally thought of as being less mobile, what's known as a less mobile factor of production than capital. So if capital can respond to the change in the tax rate, but labor finds it hard to do that, then who's going to bear the brunt of the tax? It's going to be labor. And that's why most economists, all economists, would agree that the company tax rate, the economic incidence of it, is actually on workers, not on firms. Now, don't get me wrong, firms want to pay less tax, okay? But this is why, until relatively recently, a number of people on the labor side of politics said, we should lower the company tax rate to 25%. That's a good idea. This is why Paul Keating, when he was treasurer and then prime minister, but he did most of this while he was treasurer, radically lowered the company tax rate, because he understood that it would create more jobs, more employment, and higher wages. And it did. So that's the nub of that argument. It's another example of where economics can be a little bit counterintuitive. And the reason that it's sometimes a little bit counterintuitive is that there's lots of things that can change when you change something, okay? People change all sorts of other actions in response to a given change. And you really need to think through the equilibrium of the whole system, not just look at the effect, the first sort of partial effect of a change. You have to think about how the rest of the system responds to the change and how those things interact. So that's how I understand the company tax debate. I've taken a very clear stance on this in newspaper articles written, in fact, in The Australian and in The Financial Review, about it being a good idea to lower the company tax rate. That's my view. Okay. President Trump. So no one saw this coming, right, the whole Trump presidency. I must say, I didn't see it coming either, but I did write in an article a week or two before the election that the current odds that Trump was going to win the election were about the same as a professional golfer missing a 6-foot putt. And I guess our professional golfer, I guess Hillary Clinton's putting was off on the day. And so we've got Donald Trump as president of the United States. And he's trying to do a bunch of things, and I won't get into that, but one of the things he wants to do is roll back a bunch of the environmental protections that were enacted during the Obama presidency. So as The Australian reports, and I have this stuff from all over the place, it was all in the Wall Street Journal today and in the New York Times and in the Washington Post, Donald Trump declared an end to the war on coal. As I didn't know there was a war, I thought it was a war on poverty, but apparently there's a war on coal. Feel bad for the coal getting attacked in this way, as he unveiled a sweeping assault on Barack Obama's climate change legacy yesterday. The US president signed several pro-fossil fuel changes that placed job creation ahead of laws restricting carbon emissions, which he described as job killers. In doing so, he unraveled much of his predecessor's climate change initiatives, including ordering a review of Mr. Obama's signature clean power plan that restricts greenhouse gas emissions at coal-fired power plants. That is what it's all about, bringing back our jobs, bringing back our dreams, and making America wealthy again, okay? So it's gonna be the best, this policy. So that's just one example of a discussion that's been going on for a great many years about a very, very pressing issue, right, which is climate change. And what have most economists said as their response to what we should do about climate change? We should have a carbon tax, right? Or in the attempt to make the language, I made fun of this in the press quite a bit, in attempt to make the language sound less bad, a price on carbon, which is a carbon tax, okay? And people have talked about having an emissions trading scheme as an alternative, okay? So what's the economics of that? Why does that work? Well, it's to do with something known as an externality, and you'll see this in, I think, the penultimate week of this course. You'll talk about externalities. What's an externality? An externality is something that's not part of the price mechanism. Okay, so we know already from our supply and demand that what does the price mechanism do? It balances supply and demand to reach a market equilibrium. But what happens if there's something that has a social cost that's not part of the price mechanism? Well, then the price mechanism is going to get things wrong. And there's a really simple picture that you can draw to see this. So we'll go back to our price and our quantity. Okay, and then imagine that there's some demand curve that I'll draw like that, and there's some marginal cost curve for the industry, and imagine that there's some marginal external cost, I'll call it. This is the externality. So think of it in this instance as pollution, because the Q is the amount of carbon we emit, okay, or the amount of energy we produce, let's say that, and in producing that energy we emit some carbon. And that's not, without a carbon tax, that's not captured in the price mechanism. Okay, so what's the equilibrium, you know, price and quantity going to be if we have price equals marginal cost? It's going to be just that. Let's go to the next slide and draw this again with, oops, that's not what I want. Let me try this. Let's draw this with a demand curve like that, and draw this with a marginal cost curve like that, and then draw this with what I'll call marginal social cost. Okay? So see that higher curve? I've lost my ability to draw. See that higher curve? That's the curve that takes account of the social cost that's included in things. And you know, if you just glance at it, you will see that the equilibrium, is that now back on the, Alberto's much better at many things than I am, including technology. So look at that price, I'll call that P double star, and I'll call that P star, and I'll call this Q double star, and I'll call this Q star, and I'll call this marginal cost, and I'll call this marginal social cost. Notice that when we take account of the social cost, say the pollution, okay, society wants to consume less in equilibrium, okay, and the price is going to be higher. Okay, now, another way to put that is that Q star is bigger than Q double star. Without the carbon tax, without internalizing the externality into the price mechanism, there's going to be too much produced. The price mechanism is not balancing the good things about pollution and the bad things about pollution because it's not being taken account of. Okay? And as a result of it not being taken account of, society's going to produce too much of it. And so why economists are generally for a carbon tax is that if you get the tax rate right, then what you can do is just let the price mechanism work its magic. And you can say, you know what? The price of electricity is going to be a bit higher because it's produced by coal-fired power plants in part. And you know, we're going to charge you more to turn a light on or run your air conditioner or whatever it might be, drive a car, because we know that there's this social cost to it. And so economists have for a very long time understood, back to the 1970s, have understood how to do this. In an emissions trading scheme, you'll go through this. That's just another way to do it, working on the quantity side, not working on the price side. It's in many ways, not every way, but in many ways equivalent. It's certainly equivalent in terms of the behavior it induces if done right. And so economists have understood the answer to this for a long time. In fact, an economist at MIT, Richard Schmalensee, when he was on the Council of Economic Advisors, introduced exactly an emissions trading scheme, a permit scheme, for sulfur dioxide emissions. This is the stuff that led to, again, this would be before your time, there was this thing called acid rain, like bad. It's like rain that, you know, acid, no good. And it was caused in no small part by sulfur dioxide emissions. And The administration at the time introduced this trading scheme for that. Acid rain gone as a result of this. So it can be done, it does work, but politically it's a problem these days, as you've seen. Okay, but again, what's it all about? It's not complicated. Okay, it's just your price theory. It's just supply and demand. Okay, let me try and talk about two more things quickly before maybe we'll have a few questions, maybe we'll wrap up. So one of the ones I was going to talk about, there's an article on this, is payday lending. Okay, so what's payday lending? This is more prevalent in the United States, but as you can see, it's becoming more common in Australia. So payday lending is where people get a very short-term loan that is meant to sort of stave off lack of money until the next time they get paid. And the interest rates charged on these things are often very high. So in the United States, the annual percentage rate on these things is often like 800% per annum, okay? So this is like what you see in the movies when, you know, people talk about charging a VIG and stuff like this. This is a lot, right? You do 10% for 4 days and then compound that annually, that turns out to be a lot of money, okay? That's the power of compounding. And there's a lot of concern about how you might regulate this. In the Australian context, what we've seen recently is some stuff that's related. They've talked about it as payday lending, but also about other things. Consumer groups are demanding the federal government acts on its pledge to better protect vulnerable people from short-term payday lenders. The government has yet to act on its November promise that it would introduce recommendations in a review it commissioned, which included capping monthly consumer lease fees as a proportion of the size of the loan and the borrower's income. The review found that some people pay $3,000 for $345 closed draws with interest rates equivalent to 884%. These are some of these higher purchase schemes and stuff, so it's connected to payday lending, okay? So is it a good idea to ban this stuff? Yes, no? Who thinks it's a good idea to ban this and say you can't charge such high interest rates? Who thinks it's not a good idea to do it? Okay. 800 people are indifferent. Okay. I have no view. So here are the potential unintended consequences that can come from this. Okay, so one of the great lessons of economics is when you make a policy change, you might get some consequence that wasn't intentional, that you didn't intend, that comes as a result of this. So what's one of those that could happen? Well, one of those that could happen is, imagine there are two types of people who avail themselves of this. People who just really need the clothes dryer, really need the furniture, okay? And they're gonna pay back the loan fairly quickly. So they're not gonna pay $3,000 for it. They're gonna pay much less because they're gonna pay back the loan fairly quickly. So they pay the 20% per whatever interest rate, per month interest rate, but maybe they only pay it for a month. And they get the stuff earlier and they can dry their clothes, their kids are happy, it's all good. And then there are other people who take a long time and say, oh, it's only another $100 this month, it's only another $100 this month, and pretty soon they've paid $3,000 for the $345 clothes dry. So imagine there are those two types of people. And now let's say we institute a ban on charging high interest rates, we introduce a cap. Okay? Now, why do you think people were charging those high interest rates in the first place? Well, part of it is because they're businesses that want to make money. Part of it is some of the people don't pay back the loans, right? They get the furniture or the clothes dryer and they use it, and then what are you going to do if they don't pay? Well, you can go and take it back, but what's used furniture with, like, you know, pizza stains on it really worth? Can't sell that for very much. So when I'm a business, I'm thinking about breaking even on this, getting some return, but breaking even up to that point. I'm going to think about the fact that, well, some folks aren't going to pay back and some people are. And if the market's fairly competitive, it might not be, but suppose the market's fairly competitive, then people are going to be pushed down to their kind of break even, get some return on their capital, but basically pushed down to their break even constraint. So what happens if I then, as a regulator, come along, say, you can't charge this interest rate. What am I going to do? I'm going to do one of two things, right? I'm now worse than breaking even, so I either go out of business, don't supply the clothes dryers and the furniture to people, or I do what? Raise the price. If I raise the price, what happens to the poor folks who were paying the stuff back after a month, who just really needed it now and didn't have the cash flow but knew they would have it in a month? Well, they now have to pay a higher price. So in trying to help people, in trying to get, you know, lower interest rates, I would have had the unintended consequence of just raising the price. And that might affect some of the worst off people as a result of that. And that's just another example of where there can be unintended consequences. One of the most famous contract law cases in the United States that's taught in every first year contract law class is a case called Williams v. Walker Thomas Furniture. And it's exactly about these higher purchase arrangements. There's some wrinkles about how the collateralization worked and things like that that's interesting to contract lawyers. But it's exactly about this issue that people will respond, firms will respond to these regulations. And they might respond in a way that defeats the purpose of the regulation that you were trying to implement in the first place. Okay, let me say two very quick things, okay? So one is, so a very famous economist called Kenneth Arrow, probably as I wrote in the obituary in the Australian Financial Review, whom I consider to be the greatest economist of all time, died recently. And he has a very famous thing called Arrow's Impossibility Theorem. And it goes to, I have to say this in every, even if I'm only gonna be in a class for, you know, 100 minutes, I have to say this to every class that I ever teach, because I described it in the newspaper and I describe it in class as the second greatest intellectual contribution of the 20th century, only behind general relativity from Einstein. And it's really true. And it is about how we make choices as a society. It's about how we make collective choices, how we take all our individual preferences and aggregate them up into general choices. So I was reading, I won't put it up, but I've got it there. I was reading how the Republican caucus in Congress in the US was thinking about the healthcare decision and how they had all these disparate views. And there's this kind of sense of like, how could they not reach a consensus collective decision? And Arrow tells you exactly why. And here's an illustration of it that goes back to a French mathematician called the Marquis de Condorcet in the 18th century. And he made the following observation. He said, suppose there are three people, Ms. 1, Ms. 2, and Ms. 3 in society. And suppose there are three alternatives, A, B, and C. Okay? So they could be like where we're going to go for the three of us, three friends, and where they're going to go for dinner that evening. Okay? They could be three voters and which candidate they want elected. They could be three members of parliament and what tax rate they want implemented. It could be anything. So we'll be abstract. And suppose Ms. 1 prefers, that's what that little squiggle thing is, it's not a greater than sign, it's a preference ordering, but I'll just call it squiggle, prefers A to B to C. Suppose Ms. 2 prefers B to A to C, prefers B to C rather to A, and Ms. 3 prefers C to B to A. Now suppose we have a vote. That's a natural thing to do. Let's have a vote, okay? And if two out of three of us agree, that's a majority, and that's what we'll decide. So what happens if we have a vote and we pit A versus B? Okay, well Ms. 1 likes A better than B, okay? Ooh, the battery's running low, that's fine. Ms. 2 likes B better than A, and Ms. 3 likes B better than A. So B beats A, okay? And what happens if we compare B and C? Well, Ms. 1 likes B better than C, and Ms. 2 likes B better than C, Ms. 3 doesn't, but that's two votes for B over C, okay? So you'll see pretty quickly if you work that through that we end up with B preferred to C, C preferred to A, but A preferred to B. What? I prefer one thing to another, to the third thing, but I prefer the third thing, which was coming last, to the first. And that's what's known as an intransitivity. Okay, it's a fancy term, but it means this preference ordering doesn't add up. And it means that whether I the order of the runoff, if you like, the agenda, matters very much to what's going to get chosen. If I start with A versus B, or if I start with B versus C, it's going to affect the outcome if I do this. And as a result of that, it's going to matter what the agenda is set. So Condorcet pointed this out and said, there's this problem with majority voting, with pairwise majority voting. Okay. What Arrow showed, and he was trying to write a paper about how boards of directors would make decisions in a corporate setting. And the way he told the story was, he was trying to come up with some rule that they could use to figure out how to aggregate up their different preferences. So he said, you know, the way that they could do it is they could have a vote. Wait, that's got this problem. They could put numbers next to things. That's a thing known as the border count from another French mathematician. That's got a problem with it. And he ran out of ideas for things that could work out. And he finally said, I'm going to write down four properties that are very desirable that any way of aggregating up individual preferences should satisfy, okay, and see if I can find something that satisfies them. And what he showed, that's why it's known as Arrow's impossibility theorem, is these very natural things, like if everyone prefers one thing to another, society should prefer that thing to another. Everyone's vote should count, everyone's preferences rather should count equally. No one's preferences should determine the entire social ordering. No one should be a dictator. And finally, we should consider all possibilities. It's what's known as universal domain. And he said, it turns out there is no way. You can spend the rest of your life trying to figure out clever ways. There is no way to satisfy all those four properties simultaneously. But we are going to have to give up on something. We're going to have to rule out some alternatives. We're going to have someone be a dictator, okay, or give up on some of the other things. And that is kind of a depressing conclusion, but incredibly informative about why it's often so difficult, not just to figure out where to go for dinner, but for society to aggregate up individual preferences. And that's another example of where economics has had an impact on other fields. So this is a large field in economics known as social choice theory. This had big implications for philosophers and political theorists in how they think, and legal scholars in how they think about ordering things. I know I've run a little bit past the time that I was meant to and that I intended to. Let me just say one quick thing in closing. Your economics that you're learning in this course, and if you do, and I hope you will, take other courses in the School of Economics at UNSW, or take courses in finance and related fields, that economics is an incredibly powerful and useful lens for understanding a bunch of stuff, okay? And it's not just about understanding taxes, and it's not just about understanding GDP and growth rates. Those things are really important, and I work on them, and I care about them. But what we've learned over the last 40, 50 years is that economics is an incredibly powerful tool for thinking about almost anything in the social sciences, to do with political science, to do with sociology, to do with a whole range of aspects of human life, including health and education and economic development. And what you are learning in this course is the building blocks of how to use those tools to understand the world better. So 10 years, 20 years from now, it would be awesome if you still remembered how to calculate an elasticity. But my guess is you might not. Okay, that's not an excuse not to learn it now. My guess is you might not. But if what you take away from this and other courses is these basic economic principles for understanding and analyzing the world, then we all will have succeeded. Thanks for your time.